101.1 FM, The Answer. KDXE FM, Kamak Village, Little Rock. A Salem Media Group station. 101.1 FM, The Answer.
Do you wish you had stronger courage? Do you wish you had a stronger faith? Do you wish that in some ways that while you may feel that you're weak, that you could strengthen your spiritual stamina in order to be able to live up to the challenges that confront you in your life? Today, we're going to take a look at a man who is told to be strong and to be courageous. And as God gave Joshua that commandment, he gives that same commandment to us today. For we are to be of strength and we are to be of courage, because our strength and our courage comes from the Lord. I'd like to ask one of our members, Mitch Shelnut, if you would, Mitch, lead us in a word of prayer at this time.
Thank you, Brother Kim. Let us pray. Father in heaven, we thank you for the day. Father, we thank you for all that the blessing you've given us. Father, we have a sickness in our nation. Father, a physical sickness is affecting a lot of people. I pray for our president as he leads the country. Father, just surround him with wisdom and people that can give him wise counsel. Father, we pray for the healthcare workers as they battle this disease. Father, give them the courage and the knowledge to make decisions based on the needs of individuals. Father, we also have a spiritual sickness in this country. Father, this is a time that we need you most, and we are thankful for Brother Kim and his boldness to be able to proclaim the message on this radio show. Father, we just love you and praise you for all that you do. It's in Christ's name that I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Mitch. From the book of Joshua, chapter 1, we see an example of a man who has just been given the responsibility to lead God's people. And it's a transitional time in the nation of Israel's history because Moses, who is a prominent figure, has passed away and the Lord has called him home. And so Joshua, as we would say today, had some big shoes to fill. And as a result of that, he is starting his leadership as the leader of the nation of Israel with a commandment that was given to him by God. And that commandment that God gave him was to be strong and to be courageous. Now, I want you to put yourself in the position of Joshua for just a minute. He had the responsibility to follow a strong leader. He had the responsibility to take the nation to the next level. He had the responsibility to hold together this ragtag nation that had come through so many challenges in their life, including bondage to the Egyptian nation and the experiences of being led out by after the Egyptians had experienced the 10 plagues and the crossing of the Red Sea and the wandering the wilderness for 40 years and then finally coming to the brink of being able to lead, and all of the generations younger than he had passed away. And now the challenge fell upon Joshua after following the strong figure Moses that he was to take this nation and lead them into the promised land. You know, when God issued the challenge to Joshua to be strong and to be courageous, it wasn't only for the purpose that he would be a good leader, but it was also for the purpose that he could find his identity as a leader, that he wouldn't live under the shadow of Moses, who had been such a strong force in the nation of Israel's history, that Joshua would find his leadership identity, but yet he would not forget the lessons and the examples that Moses had given him, not only through Joshua's life, but preceding Joshua's life, that as he looked back over the example of Moses and the history of Moses' life, that he would be able to glean from it all the things that he needed to have in his life in order to not be the same leader that Moses was, but to be a better leader than Moses was. And so let's begin by taking a look at some of the things we know about Moses. One of the things we know about Moses is that he was born as a Hebrew baby and that he was born to a Levite woman in the book of Exodus chapter 2 and verse 1. Now, sidebar, if you want to get the notes of the message this morning, you can go up to SalineMBC.org, Saline as in Missionary Baptist Church.org, and the notes will be up on the website if you want to pull those down. One of the things we know about Moses, he was born to a Hebrew family, and he was born to a Levite woman. At 3 months old, he was found by the Pharaoh's daughter in a wicker basket, as we would call it today, that was placed in the River Nile, because you may remember that at that time, the baby boys were to be killed. And so as a result, we find that Moses' mama hid him in the basket and placed him in the Nile. And it was strategically done because God wanted to make sure that Moses would be preserved for a leadership role that he had for him to come back one day and to lead the Egyptian nation or to lead the Israeli nation. We find that he is returned to his mother for a short period of time. And then after that, he was to be returned to the Pharaoh's daughter, who at that time gave him the name Moses, referring to that he had drawn him or that she had drawn him out of the water in the book of Exodus chapter 2 and verse 7. Now, what's interesting is when you go over to the book of Acts chapter 7, you'll find a real short, concise narrative of the life of Moses. And Stephen is using the life of Moses whenever it is that he was before his false accusers, who ultimately would kill Stephen because he called them what they were. And as a result of it, we find that Stephen used the strength of Moses and the life of Moses to convict those individuals that were trying to kill him. One of the things we find as we look at the book of Acts chapter 7 and verses 20 and 22 was a couple of the qualities about Moses. It says that during that time, he was not an ordinary child. For the Bible says at that time, Moses was born and he was no ordinary child. The book of Acts chapter 7 and verse 20. In the book of Acts chapter 7 and verse 22, it tells us that he was well educated in the wisdom of the Egyptians and was powerful in speech and in action. God had his hand on Moses, and that Moses was allowed to be born for a designed purpose that God was going to give him, and that Moses would have to become less dependent upon himself and more dependent upon God. And that is a pattern that we need to follow today. We may not lead a nation, but we are a leader within our own ranks and within our own circles in life. And I've always said it's not a question of are you a leader, it's a question of what kind of leader are you, whether you're a leader of one or two or three, or whether you're a leader of a nation. The one thing we need to realize is that because we are born, and this is why we emphasize the value and the preciousness of life, and that every life is precious, And every life that is conceived deserves the opportunity to be born so that God's will can be carried out in that person's life. Because as God had Moses selected for a job, he has a job for you as well. Each one of us are significant in the eyes of God. And one of the things that God wants us to strive and that he wants us to achieve is that we learn to live our life on the strength of God, that we might display a courageous nature before a world or before whoever it is that God chooses for us to be a leader of. Moses, at the age of 40, is when he killed the Egyptian. He had come back. He had been placed in Pharaoh's daughter's home as to be raised by her. He was well-educated. He was savvy in all the Egyptian ways. But yet, the one thing I want you to notice, at age 40, he spied an Egyptian who was beating up on an Israeli slave. And when he looked around to make sure that nobody was looking, he went in and he killed that Egyptian to defend the Israelite. Now, I want you to think about it for a minute, that Moses was a person who was proficient in the Egyptian ways. He was proficient in the language. He was proficient in the customs. And that was his life up to that time. But deep in his heart, he knew who he was. Deep in his heart, he knew where his love and his loyalty was. We cannot condone Moses for killing the Egyptian because it was not justified at all. But yet, that was the opportunity that God was going to take Moses away from that environment at that time, and he would develop him to come back and be a leader at that time. We find that as you look at how Moses had gone out and how he had killed that Egyptian, he thought that nobody would notice. But yet, we find the next day when he came back and he found two Israelites fighting among themselves, and he stepped in and he said, "Y'all shouldn't be doing that." And they said, "Who made you judge over us? Are you going to kill one of us as well?" And you see, Moses knew then that he had been discovered. Anything and everything we do will be discovered. There's a scripture that says, "Be sure your sins will find you out." Moses' sin found him out. But as a result of it, God would not make that the end of the story. Instead, it was just a chapter within the book of the life of Moses that would give him the opportunity to be taken away from that environment at the time that he was, so that God could take him into another environment and condition him. But in the heart of Moses, he always knew where his first love and his first loyalty was. Even though he was displaced, even though he had all the tools of the Egyptian day of that time, yet in his heart, he knew where his loyalty rested. Moses, who thought that his fellow Israelites would recognize that he would be a leader and that he could be someone that could lead him out of the bondage, realized real quickly that his Israelites at the time had little use for him. And Moses learned the lesson of Zechariah chapter 4 and verse 6 that said, "Not by might nor by power, but by my spirit, says the Lord." And that's why God had to remove Moses at the time, when it seemed like everything was right, except for this mistake that he made, for this sin that he had committed, this crime that he had committed. Yet God wanted to teach him that it was not going to be by the might of Moses, nor was it going to be by the power of Moses. It was going to be by the Spirit of the Lord. You know, sometimes you can be doing everything right, and maybe even you've done something wrong. And as a result of that decision, it has displaced you temporarily in life. Maybe the way we need to look at it is that God wants to take us and put us in another environment to where we can realize that no circumstance in our life can we always have ultimate control or power over, but by the Spirit of God, we can develop a courageous spirit and a strong dependency upon the Lord, which is what God wants. Moses realized that Pharaoh sought to kill him when he found out that Moses had killed that Israelite. And as a result, he fled, according to the book of Exodus, chapter 2, and verse 15. Moses fled to Midian, where he began his time picking right up where he left off. He was fighting some shepherds who were refusing to let the seven daughters of Reuel be able to water their daddy's flock. Moses stepped in, and he fought them off, and as a result of it, he found his way home to Reuel. And there, he married one of his daughters, Zipporah. And together they had two sons. The first one was named Gershom, meaning I have become an alien in the foreign land. Book of Exodus, chapter 2, 21 through 22. And what's interesting is this is still accounted for in the book of Acts, chapter 7 and verse 29. Stephen is using this as a defense as he was pleading his case before those who would stone him in just a short time. He was using the example of Moses to strengthen him. Moses would remain a foreigner in Midian for 40 years, according to the book of Acts, chapter 7 and verse 30. All the meanwhile, while this is going on, go back to Exodus chapter 2, because the Bible says, the Israelites groaned in their slavery and cried out, and their cry for help because of their slavery went up before God. And God heard their groaning, and remembered his covenant with Abraham, with Isaac, and with Jacob. And so God looked on the Israelites and was concerned about them. Let me just ask you, are you groaning today because of maybe the slavery that you're in? Are you groaning today because of the hardships that you're in? Are you crying out to God, asking God to help you because of what's going on in your life today? I want you to remember this. God hears it. Now, in that moment, he may not deliver you from whatever it is that you're in bondage to. But that doesn't mean that God doesn't hear and that God isn't preparing a way for you to be delivered from it, just like he did with the Egyptians. Here is Moses separated from his people for over 40 years, but yet his mind and his heart was always back with his people. He wanted to go back to them. And even though the name that he gave his son was referred to as because I'm an alien in a foreign land, the desire of Moses was always to go back to his people and to liberate them from what they were in bondage to. God wants to liberate you today too. God wants to liberate you if you don't know Christ as your Savior from your sins that will otherwise send you to hell, and that he wants you to receive Christ as your Savior and give you the gift of eternal life. Because while we may be in bondage in certain circumstances of this life, we will not be in bondage in hell forever because we have been delivered from hell by the blood of Christ, who that if we will just ask him to forgive us of our sins and give us the gift of eternal life, he will give us a place in heaven. And even though we may remain in bondage to certain things in this life, situations and challenges that just seem to overtake us, and we wonder, has God or is God hearing our cries? Always know this, that God hears all of our cries, and one day he will deliver us from it. Moses, who after 40 years would receive a call from God to go back to Egypt and set his people free. This is confirmed when he had the burning bush experience as he was taking his father-in-law's flock out to pasture. And as a result of it, he came upon the burning bush in the book of Exodus chapter 3. And again, still mentioned by Stephen in the book of Acts chapter 7, 30 through 34. Moses' curiosity brought him to investigate the burning bush on Mount Horeb, which is called the Mountain of God. And Moses, who said, when God called his name, here am I. Are you willing to make yourself available to God? Maybe through some unique circumstances of life, as Mitch prayed a while ago, and what we're experiencing as a nation, what the world is experiencing, and the desire for people to find answers to the questions of why this is going on and the challenges and the circumstances that this has brought on to us. Are you willing to say to God, here am I? Moses was in a foreign land. He was in a displaced location. He was not where he wanted to be. His heart was somewhere else while his body was there. And God arranged for him to go back. But it was because Moses was willing to answer God when he called his name. He said, here am I. I'm available. I'm listening. I'm ready to do whatever you want me to do. I've learned from the errors of my ways of the past. And I'm ready to go back to where my heart is, and I'm ready to invest where you want me to invest. Moses was told, don't come any closer. It's not that God didn't want Moses close to him spiritually. It was that Moses could not exist physically if he came any closer to God. We may not be able to see God with our eyes, but yet we can experience him and feel the closeness of him within our heart if we're willing to say to God, here am I. Make me expendable. Make everything I have expendable. Let me put myself in your care and in your hands, and here am I. Moses was told to take off your sandals, for the place where you are standing is holy ground, and thus we get the song, Holy Ground. I tell you, every once in a while, I think it'd be great if we in our spiritual relationship with God would have that same experience that we feel like we're standing on holy ground. I will tell you, one of the things that I long for that I know many of you do is for us to be reunited as congregations to where we can worship together. I put out on Facebook a message, if what's the first song you want to hear sung when you come back into the services and have the chance to stand together? And some of y'all mentioned that song, "We Are Standing on Holy Ground." It's not the ground that's under our feet that makes it holy. It's where our heart is placed that makes it holy. Moses said, "Here am I." God said, "I am here with you." And a willing heart and a loving Father makes it holy ground when God's people come together and we align ourselves with what God wants us to do. Moses, who had to hide his face when he realized he was in the presence of God and could not look upon God any longer. Moses, this is all who Joshua has to fill the shoes of. Moses, who God was sending to Pharaoh to bring his people back to bring his people Israel out of the bondage of the Egyptians in chapter 3 and verse 10 of Exodus. Moses, who said, "Here am I that I should go," or "Who am I that I should go to the Pharaoh and bring the Israelites out of Egypt?" Now, I want you to go back to where we started a while ago. You remember how that was referenced in the book of Acts chapter 7 and how it was referenced in the early life and the account of the life of Moses, how that he was not an ordinary person, that God had called him to a specific challenge. You're not an ordinary person either. You may feel ordinary, but you're not ordinary because you are the only one that God made with your image and with your DNA. God has a calling for you. God has a purpose for you. God has a use for you. You are not ordinary in God's eyes. You may be ordinary in the eyes of the world, but the world is not who we serve, nor should it be who we serve. God has made you extraordinary in some way, some unique way, that he can use you to reach others, that he can use you to lead people out of the bondage of sin and find their way to eternal life in Jesus Christ. Moses, you remember, was well-educated in the ways of Egypt. I often wondered, why didn't God pick somebody that was already back in Egypt? Why did he have to get Moses to come back? Well, one of the things I thought about was that the people that were in bondage probably would not have respected anybody else that was there among them. They needed somebody who could come in, for all practical purposes, was an unknown person that could come in and lead them out of their bondage. So God put it on Moses' heart, and I believe that God had him separated for that long period of time, that while he was well-educated in the way of the Egyptians that he had not forgotten, when God brought him back onto the scene, God would be able to use Moses with his skill sets in order to be able to stand toe-to-toe with Pharaoh. But it wasn't going to be because Moses was well-educated or because he was extraordinary. It was going to be because God had purposed that he should go and do this specific job that he had for him. And so it is with you and I. We may have our own individual skill sets, but if we're not where we are because God has placed us there, our individual skill sets will fail us, and we will not be courageous, and we will not be strong, as Moses showed some examples throughout the rest of his life, that when he relapsed and went back to counting on himself, that's when he failed. But when he counted on God, that's when he succeeded. Moses was given insight to a future meeting that God and him would have on the very mountain that he was talking to God in the book of Exodus chapter 3 and verse 12, and then go over to Exodus chapter 19 and verse 2. A message of hope that God gave to Moses is that this is not the last time I'll see you. We will be back together again, when he gave him the Ten Commandments and the law. Moses, this same Moses, after all this that I've just shared with you, this same Moses began to make excuses to God. Here are the excuses that he gave. And as I give these excuses, of which there were three, I want you to think in your life, what excuses am I making to God that prohibits or limits God's ability to use me in an extraordinary way because God has uniquely made me? What excuses are you offering to God? Here's the ones that Moses gave. He said, well, what if they want to know who sent me? Who should I say sent me? And God said, you tell them that I am who I am has sent you, Exodus 3:14. God is self-contained. God doesn't need the help of anybody. He is within himself who he is. I am that I am has sent you. You know, whenever it is that we go to people and we share with people the plan of salvation, or we share with others as far as what God is doing in a unique way in our life, and they say, well, how is it that that is happening? We should do the same thing that Moses was told to do, and that is give God the glory, give God the credit, and give God the responsibility to do what only God can do in that person's life as we share with them what God has done in our life. When you go on the second excuse, Moses says, what if they don't believe me? Chapter 4 and verse 1. Well, then, show them the miracles that I allow you to perform. And there were three miracles that he showed them in order to convince them that he was sent by God. There was the staff that when he threw it down, it turned into a snake. There was the hand that became leprous that when he put it in his cloak and he pulled it out, it was leprous. When he put it back in and pulled it back out, it was clean. And then there was the water turned into blood. Three different miracles. Now, let me tell you, I don't believe if I had a rod in my hand, I threw it down, it would be a snake today. I believe this hand would be the hand it is. If I put it in my jacket or I pull it out, it would be the same hand. I don't believe I can turn water into blood. But I do know that God has worked in my life in many ways and many circumstances that I cannot explain with any human logic. I cannot explain with any human rationale. While it may be that we would classify it maybe not as a miracle, it is evidence of the presence of God. And that's what it was all about. It didn't matter whether it was a staff. It didn't matter whether it was a leprous hand. It didn't matter whether it was water turned into blood. That is irrelevant. What is relevant is that the presence of God was with Moses, that if God gave Moses a job to do, God was not going to send him out on his own. God was going to be right there with him. And if the people chose not to believe, God would give them evidence so that they would know that Moses had sent them. There are many things that if you live very long as a child of God, just going back to the sheer fact that you accepted Christ as your Savior and you were delivered from the bondage of sin, like Moses was going to come and deliver the nation of Israel from the bondage of the Egyptians, that within itself is a testimony strong enough that if you are willing to share it, God will take care of the rest. And then as a child of God, if you've lived as a child of God very long, the things that God has done in your life and God has done for you, that if you would begin to keep a journal, if you would begin to keep a list, that when people ask you, well, who is it that has done for you what you want to do for me? You would be able to give them evidences of all the blessings that God has given you in your life. The third thing is Moses, and the third excuse is this, what if I can't speak elegant enough? So God gave Moses his brother Aaron, who is 3 years older than Moses, and he would always be a thorn in Moses' flesh. That's what happens when you make excuses. When you make excuses that you can't do what God has given you to do, God may give you a thorn in the flesh that makes you wish you would have just went ahead and done it in the first place instead of being saddled with something that you really wish you didn't have. It wasn't that Moses couldn't speak elegant enough. It was that Moses' faith had not yet developed, and God said, fine, I'm going to take away your excuse. I'm going to give you somebody else. And as a result of it, Moses had to deal with many hardships because of Aaron. Sure, he was his brother. Sure, he loved him. But the problem is, Moses could have done it without his brother if he would have just learned to trust God instead of making excuses. Three excuses that Moses offered to God. And here's the thing, and I want you to think about this. There was no excuse good enough that God couldn't overcome it and counteract it and keep Moses exactly where he wanted him in order to do the job that God gave him to do. And no matter what excuse you offer to God, it'll never be good enough if God has a job for you to do. This same Moses who is expendable. Actually, as he now begins to, he goes back and he tells his father-in-law, I'm going back, I'm going to deliver my God's people. He gathers up his family. And he starts back. In the book of Exodus, chapter 4, 24 through 26, It says, at a lodging place on the way, the Lord met Moses and was about to kill him. But Zipporah took a flint knife, cut off her son's foreskin, in other words, circumcised him, and touched Moses' feet with it, and said, surely you are the bridegroom of blood to me, she said. So the Lord let him alone. At that time, she said, the bridegroom of blood, referring to the circumcision. When it comes to circumcision, in order to get a full understanding of this event that happened in Moses' life, you got to go back to the book of Genesis chapter 17, when God changed the name of Abram to Abraham and initiated circumcision. And this is what the Bible says that circumcision is. As a sign of the covenant between me, that is God, and you, for the generations to come, every male among you who is 8 days old must be circumcised, including those born in the household of bought with money from a foreigner, those who are not your offspring. Whether born in your household or bought with your money, they must be circumcised. My covenant in your flesh is to be an everlasting covenant. Any uncircumcised male who has not been circumcised in the flesh will be cut off from his people, and he has broken my covenant. This was the tool that Zipporah used as she circumcised her son, and she became a buffer between God and Moses, and in a way reminding or protecting Moses from the judgment of God and reminding God of the covenant that he had made with his people. Now remember, Zipporah was not from the Hebrew nation, but she understood and appreciated who God was and had learned the way of God from Moses as Moses taught her. That's another subject within itself. Here's what I want you to focus on, though. After all this that God and Moses have already been through up to this point, where Moses had made three excuses, but yet he was obedient in that he was going to leave the foreign land, of which his son got his name because Moses was a foreigner in a strange land, so he named his firstborn after that experience. And now Moses, having had the burning bush experience, is making his way back to Egypt to deliver his people. But yet somewhere along the line, he made God mad enough that God was about to take his life had it not been for the fact that Moses' wife intervened on his behalf and used the covenant in order to protect Moses' life. Here's the question. How mad have you made God because of the excuses and the defiant nature that are keeping you from being as strong and as courageous as God wants you to be? Moses found himself in harm's way with God. And we don't know all the details to the story. We only know what I'm sharing with you from the book of Exodus and from the book of Acts, and there are others that you can look at to build the story around it. But whatever it was that happened between Moses and God, it was enough that God thought about killing Moses. And Moses didn't even plead for his life. I'm not sure even Moses knew how mad he had made God, but his wife did, and she intervened on his behalf. The point of it is, when God has given us a job to do, we shouldn't use any excuse or do anything that would make him mad enough that he would want to make today our appointed time. Moses' first encounter with Pharaoh didn't go so good. He told him in Exodus chapter 5, verses 1 through 20, he said, let my people go so that they may worship God. Pharaoh said, who is the Lord that I should obey him and let Israel go? I do not know that Lord, and I will not let Israel go. Now, for this purpose, we know that Pharaoh, in all probability, when he died and he was laid in his tomb, that his soul was laid in hell. And on that day of judgment, when the Lord calls up the bodies of the lost and he calls the souls of the lost together, he'll forever eternity be cast into the lake of fire. He didn't want anything to do with God. And you're here, you're listening today. You may have the same attitude as Pharaoh. I don't know this God. Don't want anything to do with him. He's not my God. He's your God. The thing is, God wants you to make him your God today. And he made a way possible through his son's death, burial, and resurrection. And that by placing your trust in Christ and receiving him as your Savior, when you die, you know that you can go to heaven and you won't be joined with Pharaoh. Pharaoh increases the workload, requiring them to produce bricks without any additional supplies. Israelites turn on Moses and Aaron and say, you've made him mad. He's increased our workload. But God reminds Moses of his promise in chapter 5, 22 through chapter 6 and verse 8. But the Israelites did not listen to Moses. And because of their discouragement and because of their cruel bondage that they were experiencing, Moses and Aaron, they go back to Pharaoh. And the beginning of God's judgment through the plagues begins in chapter 6 through 13. And the Bible says, Moses and Aaron did just as the Lord commanded them. Moses was 80 years old, and Aaron was 83 when they spoke to the Pharaoh. Now, we've looked at the life of Moses, so I can bring you up to Joshua. Along the course of the life of Moses, God brings Joshua in. He is the son of Nun from the tribe of Ephraim. He was first mentioned at the Battle of the Amalekites, where he led the forces of Israel in Exodus chapter 17. He became an aide to Moses, and he accompanied him up the pathway to Mount Sinai that had been mentioned earlier to be able to receive the law and the commandments. He was one of the spies that was sent from Kadesh to view the land of Canaan. And with Caleb, he gave an encouraging report of the land, resulting in these two being admitted to the promised land while all the other adults of their generation died in the wilderness, Numbers chapter 14. He was divinely appointed and ordained as a successor to Moses in the book of Numbers chapter 27. And Moses gave him his solemn charge before all Israel in the last chapter, Deuteronomy chapter 31 through chapter 34. And immediately he began his career on a conquest in Joshua chapter 1 through 9. But how did he begin his leadership, and how was he able to be as strong and courageous as he was for the task that God had given him to do? It's because of Joshua chapter 1, 1 through 10. Look there and break it down with me. The Lord said to Joshua the very first thing. The same Lord that talked to Moses talked to Joshua. It's the same Lord that wants to talk to you today if you're willing to listen. Why is it you may not be charged with the responsibility of leading a nation into a promised land or whatever it may be? It's the same God that talked to them that wants to talk to us. The Bible says in the book of Hebrews chapter 13, toward the end or around verse 7, it says, Jesus Christ the same today, yesterday, and forever. That same God that talked to Joshua and talked to Moses is the same God that wants to talk to you and me today in order that it might build our strength and it might build our courage. He said, Moses, my servant, is dead. He just drew a line in the sand. He said, Joshua, no longer is Moses here. You can't lean on him. You're an aide to him. You saw some great things. You did some great things with him. But now it's your turn. And so it is with you and with me. Now it's our turn. It's not somebody else's responsibility to step in to be our courage and our strength. It now becomes our responsibility that we must decide with our life how we want to live it and how God will use us as we choose to live it. He goes on, he says, now then, you and all these people get ready to cross the Jordan River into the land I'm about to give them to the Israelites. He had a mission for him. God had a specific mission for Joshua, and God's got a specific mission for you and for I. Our job, our challenge is to find it and then live within it. He goes on, he says, no one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. That same God that said that to Joshua, that said that to Moses, is saying that to you. That if you will follow my leadership, God says, no one will be able to stand up against you all the days of your life. They might stand up to you, but they won't be able to stand up against you. Just as we go back to the book of Acts chapter 7, while it is that they took Stephen down physically, he was resurrected and taken up spiritually. The same thing is true for you and I today. As I was with Moses, God says, I'll be with you. That same God that was with Moses, that same God that was with Joshua, is saying to you and me today that he will be with us. And he said, I will never leave you, nor will I ever forsake you. In the book of Hebrews, chapter 13, beginning with verse 5, the Bible says this, keep your lives free from the love of money and content with what I have, because this is what God says, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. So we say with confidence, You know where confidence comes from? It comes from strength, and it comes from courage. And as a result of strength and as a result of courage, you can have confidence. The Lord is my helper. I will not be afraid. What can men do to me? That's what Stephen was saying. When he was given the recount of the life of Moses leading up to Joshua taking over, he was in his mind saying, there isn't anything you can do to me. While they were yet stoning him, the Bible says that he looked up into heaven and God took him into heaven. And he went out a faithful martyr for the cause of Christ. In the mind of Stephen, he was asking that same question that we should ask to do, that we should ask today, what can man do to me? Remember your leaders who spoke the word of God to you. Consider the outcoming of their way and life and imitate their faith. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. As Joshua was preparing to lead the people into the promised land, he was living under the principle where God said, I will never leave you. I will never forsake you. That's what builds strength and courage. It's not who you are or who I am. It wasn't Moses in all of his skilled capabilities that he had that he was set apart as being recognized as being unique, extraordinary. All that stuff counted for naught. But what counted was that he was willing to remember that God said, I will never leave you and I will never forsake you in any times. And then he said, be strong, be courageous, because you will lead these people to inherit the land that I swore to your forefathers to give them. When we are strong and we are courageous, God will lead us and we will be able to deliver on what he's given us to do. And again, he said, be very strong, be very courageous. He double emphasized it, that is what God expects of us today. God wants us to develop our spiritual strength, that we might develop our spiritual courage, so that we can, in spite of whatever man may say, as cited in Hebrews chapter 13, be able to know and to answer the question, what can men do to us? They can't do anything. Be careful to obey all the laws of my servant Moses. Later in Joshua 23:7, it says, do not associate with these nations that remain among you. You must not serve them or bow down to them. And in Joshua chapter 23:8, he said, but you are to hold fast to the Lord your God as you have until now. Be careful to obey the laws of God, because in being obedient to the laws of God, you will find your strength and you will find your courage. He told Joshua, don't turn from the right, don't turn from the left, that you may have success wherever you go. In other words, don't be distracted. What was said in the book of Matthew, or back there in the book of Hebrews chapter 13, it talked about the love of money. Money is not bad. You gotta function in life with money. Money is not an evil thing, but the love of money is. We find that God was telling Joshua, don't get distracted from the left to the right. You stay focused and zeroed in on what I tell you to do. He goes on, he says, do not let this book of the law depart from your mouth. Meditate on it day and night, so you'll be careful to do everything that is written in it. Then you will become prosperous and successful, not so much in the world, but in God. He said, and God asked him this question, and this is where we begin to wrap it up. God asked Joshua this question. He says, have I not commanded you? What did God command Joshua to do? The same thing that he commands us to do today. He says, have I not commanded you to be strong? Don't be weak. To be courageous, don't be a coward. Do not be terrified, instead be inspirational. Do not be discouraged, instead be an encourager. Why? Because the Bible says, for the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. That's why Hebrews 13:8 is so important. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday and today and forever. That same God that Joshua and Moses served is the same God that we serve today. For the Lord your God will be with you wherever you go. How can you know you're strong? How can you know you're courageous? When you know and you live as though you know that the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. As soon as Joshua got this command, he turned around and he ordered the officers of the people, and he began his journey. Then the people answered Joshua and said, "Whatever you have commanded us, we will do, and wherever you send us, we will go. Just as we fully obeyed Moses, so we will obey you. Only may the Lord your God be with you as he was with Moses. Whoever rebels against your word and does not obey your words, whatever you may command them, will be put to death. Only be strong and courageous." Now, here's what I want you to know. This is the people responding when Joshua told them, "Be strong and be courageous." And the people said, "We'll follow you wherever you go, as long as we know you're following God who's leading you where you go. And if anybody chooses not to," they were serious enough about it that they said, "We will put them to death." Their echoing words back to Joshua was this: "We're willing to do all this, but you be strong and you be courageous." And that's what we need to understand today. I need you to be strong. I need you to be courageous. And you need me to be strong. And you need me to be courageous. Because when we are together, we are strong and we are courageous for the work of the Lord. But our courage and our strength comes from God. Here's the takeaway. Live a life that is an example for someone to follow. Moses, he ended his life in a manner in which Joshua wanted to carry on the tradition. I pastored a church, an old guy said one time, and he was a very smart man, he said, "Leave the wood pile higher than you found it." In other words, leave it to where somebody can add to it. Don't be the one that takes away from it. Realize that Satan seeks to take you into bondage, but God has come to set you free. That someone will always be coming behind you, and you want that someone to advance what you started. And that's what Joshua did. Be a person in the chain of life that when the person that comes behind you that has to assume the responsibilities that you have looks to you and says, "I'm glad I was able to follow him or her because I'm able to continue on the journey of what God started in them." And make it your life goal to have what you say be good enough to put on a plaque. What do you mean? Well, Joshua, toward the end of his life, said this: "Now fear the Lord and serve him with all faithfulness. Throw away the gods of your forefathers, worship beyond the river of Egypt, and serve the Lord. But if serving the Lord seems undesirable to you, then choose for yourself this day whom you will serve, whether the gods of your forefathers served beyond the river or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living." But here it is: "But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Be strong, be courageous, serve the Lord, and God will bless you. Father, just pray that the time we've shared together today has been beneficial. And I pray, Lord, that we will be stronger and we'll be more courageous because we had the example of the life of Moses who, Father, he had many ups and downs in his life. But yet, Father, when you called him home, Father, you weren't seeking to kill him. You were seeking to bring him to his place of rest. Thank you, Lord, for the example of people like Joshua. And Father, every one of us can be a Joshua in our own little world, in our own little circle, if we just choose to follow the example that Joshua left for us as he was left with the example of Moses. May, Father, we make it a commitment on our part, on this generation, to be able to show to the younger ones coming behind us or those around us that we just want to be people who are strong and courageous in the Lord. Father, we thank you for the time, and we thank you for the freedom we enjoy as a nation to be able to do this publicly, and Father, not to live in fear of persecution. And we just pray that for those that are listening that don't know you as their Savior, that something heard or said done today will cause them to want to ask you to come into their heart, to forgive them of their sins, and give them the gift of eternal life, that they might give their life to you, and in exchange you'll give them eternal life. Help we who are Christians to live a courageous and strong life as an example to the lost around us, or those, Father, who are faltering by the wayside, that we might be a source of encouragement to them. And just pray and ask all these things in the name of Jesus Christ, the Savior. And all God's people said, amen. You can get a copy of the notes up on SalineMBC.org if you'd like to get a copy of that, or you want to send in a prayer request, or you want to send in a question that you'd like to have answered. go to Saline like the county, MBC like Missionary Baptist Church, and .com, and I'll be glad to get back to you. And Lord willing, we'll see you here next Sunday, but I pray before many Sundays, we'll be seeing each other face-to-face instead. Hope you have a great day in the Lord.
My eyes will see when you're
FM, Kamak Village, Little Rock.